Is Jesus David's son and David's Lord? Let me ask it another way. Is Jesus David's son or is he David's Lord? Last week we saw that we who are in Christ Jesus will have resurrection life after death because our God is the God of the living. So the one who raised Jesus from the dead is the same one who will raise us from the dead. The Sadducees didn't believe in the resurrection, so Jesus engaged them by going to the scriptures. He quoted Exodus chapter 3, verse 6, where God used the present tense form, I am the God of Abraham. I am the God of Isaac. I am the God of Jacob. God said this to Moses long after these three patriarchs died. Today, the question that we need to answer is Jesus the son of David, or is he the son of God? If Jesus is the son of David, then how is he David's Lord? If Jesus is only the son of David and not David's Lord, then the gospel is no longer good news. Do you see what is at stake here? And if Jesus isn't David's Lord, then there is no forgiveness. And all the saints who have passed before us are not in heaven. The doctrine of Jesus Christ is a very important doctrine. These are the questions that we will seek to answer out of Holy Scripture. So let's let Scripture inform these questions. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you first and foremost of your son Jesus, whom you sent to become man, who put on human flesh to save us from our sins by dying on the cross. We thank you that on the third day you raised him to life, thereby we have resurrection life because you are able to make dead alive. And we thank you this morning that we can rejoice because Craig has resurrection life and he is with you, worshiping you, rejoicing in you, beholding the glory of who you are. In your presence, with his glorified body, praising you. We thank you for that truth that comforts Arlen. We thank you for that truth that comforts all of us who are in Christ Jesus. And so, Father, I pray by the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to see your word today and what it means to us and how we can apply it. I pray, Father, for your help, that you would grant me clarity of thought and confidence in the enableness of the Holy Spirit, that I may speak your word and teach your word and preach your word with boldness and with clarity, that your church may be strengthened and edified, and that you would be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. This just recently, Melinda and I have been in a season of just laughing about dad jokes. So Jackson's got a whole category of dad jokes, and we just enjoy this. And here's one. Oh, I've got actually two, but I think I'll just share one with you, just to make sure that I don't go too crazy about these jokes. But here's a dad joke. One dad said, yesterday, I was washing the car with my son. My son said, Dad, can't you just use a sponge? It takes a little bit of time. That's why I pause. Here's the joke. Did the dad wash the car with his son, using his son like a sponge? Or did the dad wash the car with the help of his son? See, that joke was intentional because Jesus will ask a question that it's not quite as clear either. In fact, he will ask the question in our text that is somewhat of like a riddle. And if we solve this riddle by going to the Word of God, we will learn more about who Jesus is. It will answer the question, is the Christ David's son? Or is Jesus the Son of God? It will answer the question, is Jesus God, or is he just man? In expository sermons, typically, preachers will give the main idea of the sermon, which kind of guides the sermon. So, long story short, this is actually the answer to the question, is the Christ David's Lord? Or is he just David's son? Here's the main idea. Jesus is fully God and fully man. That's the biblical truth that we see in our text this morning. And it usually follows an application. Here's the application part. Therefore, beware. Let us beware of false teachers who deny this truth. You see, believing that Jesus is fully God and fully man solves all sorts of theological questions. Believing that Jesus is fully God and fully man makes God's grace amazing. His love so immense and his mercy so undeserving. If you understand that Jesus is fully God and he became fully man, then it will make his love so immense in your understanding. It'll make his grace so amazing if ye behold this truth. And it will make his mercy so undeserving. Our text neatly breaks into two sections. Here's the first main heading. Behold Jesus as God and man. Verse 41. But he said to them, how can they say that the Christ is David's son? That's the question. If you've been following through our sermon series in the book of Luke, you would have noticed that the book of Luke has certain questions that are asked throughout the gospel. For example, when Jesus healed the paralytic man, he forgave him over sins, and the Pharisees asked, who is this who speaks blasphemies? Luke 5, verse 21. Another example is this. When John heard of the report of Jesus, he asked, are you the one who is to come, or should we wait for another? Luke 7, verses 19 through 20. Here's another question that was posed in the book of Luke. After Jesus calmed the wind and the raging waves, Jesus asked, where is your faith? Luke 8, 25. Fast forward in our series in Luke, after the seven brothers died and the widow died childless, the Pharisees and the Herodians asked, in the resurrection, whose wife will the woman be? Chapter 20, verse 33. As children, we all went through the questions season, didn't we? Do you remember as a child having all these questions? Like, why is the sky blue? Or the water wet? Why can't we feel the wind? Remember those questions that you used to have? Life is full of questions. I remember when Jackson, our youngest son, was just a little chap, and we were traveling in our car. He was in his back seat, in a car seat, and he would ask me this question: Dad, why did God make the sky so high? I don't know. I was driving at the time. I couldn't give it any deep thought. So I turned the question around and asked him, why do you think God made the sky so high? He said, so the birds don't hit their heads. We all have many questions. Perhaps you're going through a hard season right now. Perhaps you're suffering and you're hurting. And you have questions that are serious that needs to be answered. And I want you to know, church, that it's okay to have questions about life when things get hard. It's okay to ask God these questions that are so difficult in yours and in my life. I just want to encourage you, go talk to people that you trust. Go talk to people that you know that they love you, and ask them. Dig deep into Holy Scripture. Read the book of Proverbs. Read the book of Psalms. Because the Word of God and the Spirit of God will reveal the answers to your questions. Maybe you're an unbeliever this morning, and maybe you're here. Maybe you're watching online, and you're a bit of a skeptic about Jesus. You can kind of concede that, yeah, he was a man, but maybe you don't believe that he is God himself. If you're a skeptic about Jesus, I'm so glad that you're here. We are so glad that you're here. If you're listening online, I'm so glad that you're listening. I just want to encourage you, as you continue to pursue these questions about who Jesus is, read the Word of God. It's the only book in all the earth that is infallible. It is inerrant. It is without error. It has been proven over and over and over that it is faithful and truthful and is able to bring transformation and life into a dead soul. It is able to bring comfort and peace to a hurting soul. It is able to bring restoration and reconciliation between marriages of a husband and wife. Who are separated, who are arguing and fighting. Let the Word of God and the Spirit of God reveal these answers to you. Every question that Jesus' enemies, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and the Herodians asked him, he answered them masterfully. And so his enemies accepted their defeat, and they no longer desired to ask him any more questions. We see this in chapter 20, verse 40. Well, in our text today, Jesus turns the table around against his enemies by asking them a question. Now, I'm going to cite Matthew's parallel account in chapter 22. Verses 41 to 42. It says this: Now while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus' enemies, Jesus asked them a question saying, "What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" They said to him, "The son of David." You see, the Pharisees believed that Jesus was the son of David, but they were expecting a human ruler. So they denied that Jesus is the son of God. So Jesus asked them in our text, "How can you say that the Christ is David's son?" Verse 42, "For David himself says in the book of Psalms, 'The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool.'" This question is like a riddle. But if we figure out the solutions to this riddle, then we gain a greater understanding of the personhood of Jesus Christ. The divinity of Jesus Christ. You see, when we have a greater understanding of who Jesus is, our faith will be made certain. That's really the main purpose of why Luke wrote the Gospel of Luke. It's so that our faith may be made certain. So, to solve this riddle, he began with common knowledge to prove that he is the Son of God and the Son of David. You see, back then it was commonly believed that the Messiah would come from the lineage of King David. And so as a Jew back then, if you read your Bible, which is now our Old Testament, then you would have expected the Messiah to come in a physical, bodily form. Isaiah 9 foretells this. It says, unto the people of God, a child will be born, a son will be given. And the government shall be upon his shoulder, and the increase of his government and of peace, there will be no end. And he will reign on David's throne and rule over his kingdom forever. This is what you would have read as a Jew back in Jesus' day. There was this foretelling of the coming Christ, the Messiah. In Jesus' day, he clearly fulfilled these prophetic words in the Old Testament by being the Son of God. Do you remember in Luke chapter 1, verse 27, that his father, Joseph, was from the house of David? That the Lord will give him the throne of his father, David, chapter 1, verse 32. Jesus clearly came from the lineage of David. Even in the New Testament, Matthew in chapter 1, verse 1, and Paul in Romans 1, verse 3, affirm that Jesus came from the lineage of David. And so by all these accounts, in that day, everyone knew that Jesus was the son of David. But this only solves one part of the riddle. Jesus asked them, "But how can the Christ be David's son and David's Lord at the same time?" Do you get the question? If Jesus is David's son and the Pharisees, his enemies, conceded to that, how can Jesus be David's son and yet at the same time be David's Lord? To solve this riddle, Jesus went straight to Scripture. He cited Psalm 110, verse 1, which is a psalm that David himself wrote. Psalm 110 is a messianic psalm, which means that these messianic psalms foretell the coming of the Christ. One author commented, "In fact, all the ancient rabbis agreed that David was prophesying here about the Christ." Psalm 110 is the most quoted psalm in the New Testament. In fact, the author of Hebrews quoted Psalm 110 four times. Peter quoted Psalm 110 in Acts chapter 2, verses 34 through 36. And so Jesus asked, how can the Christ be David's son and his Lord at the same time? Let me put it in a different question form. If Jesus was a man, how can he be God? Well, the answer lies in Holy Scripture in Psalm 110, but it's a bit confusing, so it's going to take a little bit of explaining. You see, there are two persons in this conversation, and they're both called Lord. You see that? The Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. This has confused me at times when I read this earlier in my walk with Christ. Who is Lord one and who is Lord two? Well, the first Lord is God himself. You see, most of our English Bibles print the letters O-R-D in small capital letters to differentiate one from the other. If you look at your Bible in Psalm 110, verse 1, you might see the difference there. You see the first one? O-R-D is in capital letters, but it's in smaller case. And the other one is in regular form. One commentator said, David is using the name Yahweh here. Since we're not all versed in Hebrew, we have to use some commentaries. You can actually go online in a Hebrew app and look up this verse. And it actually is the name Yahweh. Yahweh is the word used for the first Lord. And commentators would say this is the designation of a special divine name that belongs only to God. And so the person speaking in this verse is the Lord God Almighty. If the first Lord is God the Father, then who is the second Lord in this text? Well, if we look at this text in the Hebrew language, David actually uses a different word. It's the word Adonai. The meaning of this word is a bit more general. The meaning of Adonai can be master, sir, owner, Lord. And it can be used to describe anyone who meets this description. Now, this designation, the second Lord, is not as obvious about who it's referring to, but if you look at the context of Psalm 110, the second Lord here represents the coming Christ. According to one Bible commentator, one Bible scholar, we can read it in this way. The Lord God says to my Lord, the Messiah, sit on my throne to rule the universe. That's one way we can read it in our vernacular. So the first Lord is God the Father, and the second Lord is God the Son. Maybe you're still a little confused, so let me go at it in a different way, a different direction. Again, let me state the problem. What's so confusing about this is if Jesus is the son of David, then how can David call him his Lord? You see, after becoming king, there was no one higher than David. Yet he called Christ his Lord. Again, let me reiterate the question. If Jesus is the son of David, then how can he call Jesus Lord? You see, in the Hebrew culture, no father called their son Lord. And so how can Jesus be David's son and David's Lord at the same time? Here's how. The answer can also be found in Jesus' divinity and his humanity. You see, by his virgin birth, as God the Son incarnate, he became David's son. By his life, death, resurrection, and ascension, now ruling and reigning at the right hand of God the Father, he became David's Lord. Does that help? Very good. Therefore, church, Jesus is fully man and fully God. Jesus used scripture to prove that he's not only the son of David, but he is also the son of God. I like how one author put it. He says this, the Christ was David's Lord because he is David's God. Jesus is both David's creator God and his human son. Jesus is fully God and fully man. Now, I've met some people who struggle with the humanity of Jesus. Why did God the Son have to become fully man? Dr. Wayne Grudem was very helpful in this answer. He was my professor at the Pastor's College. The question is, if Jesus was fully God, then why did he have to become fully man? Here's a possible answer. Jesus became fully man because we needed a perfect representative. You see, where Adam failed in obeying God perfectly, Jesus came in the human flesh and obeyed God the Father perfectly on our behalf. Jesus became man because we needed a perfect substitute sacrifice. You see, our substitute to pay for the wages of our sin, which is death, had to be perfect. Our substitute had to be holy and blameless and spotless. Jesus became man to be that for us. Jesus became man so that we can have a faithful advocate. Having put on human flesh, he was tempted in every way common to every man, every woman, yet he remained without sin. He understands our temptations and the draw of the world. And because he understands, he can be our faithful advocate, pleading on our behalf to God our Father. When the devil seeks to bring accusations and deceitful thoughts into your hearts and your minds that you're no good, that you're worthless, that you're a failure, no one loves you, you're not valuable. Jesus, our advocate, by the Holy Spirit, indwelling in your heart, will tell you, you are loved. You are valuable. You have much worth. And you are very much needed. That is the active role of Jesus Christ as our advocate. You see, church, we all need a Savior, but we also need a friend in Jesus. Jesus stooped way down and became man so that he can save us. And as our Savior, he also became our Lord. He is now seated at the right hand of God the Father. And he is ruling and reigning. And he has put all of his enemies under his feet. I should have gotten an amen on that. Here's why. Our enemies are also his enemies. And he has put all of our enemies under his feet. You see, our greatest enemies in this life is sin, Satan, and death. And all three are under Jesus' feet. You might ask how? Here's how. At the cradle, in his humility, he became like a baby to be the savior of the world. At the cross, he is and was our perfect sacrifice. He paid for our sins by his death. Thereby, sin and guilt can no longer be counted against us if you're in Christ Jesus. By his perfect sacrifice and his atoning and willing death, sin no longer has any grip on us. Therefore, Satan no longer has dominion over me and you. At the grave, Jesus rose, defeating our death by his death and the power of the resurrection life. If you believe that Jesus is both fully God and fully man, then you can have peace no matter what this world brings into your life. The answers to our hard questions will always and can always be found in the person and work of Jesus Christ, the God-man. Behold Jesus as God and man. Next, beware of false teachers and abuse. That's the next main heading. You see, the Pharisees didn't believe in Jesus because they did not know Scripture. Therefore, they denied that Jesus was the Son of God. They didn't believe in Jesus because their hearts were already hardened. Their eyes were already blind because of their sin. Having effectively shut down his enemies, the Pharisees, he then turned his attention to all those who were listening and gave them a warning. He warned them, and he's warning us today, beware of false teachers. Beware of the scribes. What's nice about this back then, and even today, is that these false teachers are easy to spot. Can we put those pictures up there? There's a couple, as an example. Now, I believe that Benny Hinn has come to repentance. I heard that, but I can't confirm that or deny that. But we have false teachers in our day, the prosperity preachers. You see, they valued public recognition instead of personal godliness. So they walked around in these special robes back then. They valued being first in the public eyes at the feast. So they put God second in the background. Jesus tells us that these false teachers took advantage of widows. One commentary said that they cheated widows out of their inheritance. And these false teachers tells us in God's word tells us that these false teachers will have a greater condemnation. This is why the Apostle James says in James chapter 3, verse 1, that not many should aspire to become teachers, because all those who teach and preach God's word will be judged with greater strictness. This is why I'm so grateful to you, church, for your faithful giving and your sacrificial giving, because your giving allows me to be able to just devote myself full time to the study of God's word. I don't have to go work a secular job to provide for my family financially. And I'm able to actually sit down and read and study and pray to be able to bring a healthy teaching of God's word. Amen. Thank you. So thank you for your faithfulness in your giving. All of the religious duties that the Pharisees and the scribes did publicly were nothing but a show. You see, they didn't love God. They loved themselves. Unless we too get prideful, some of us get caught up in the same temptations. Some people find their identity in the clothes that they wear. They have to wear Giorgio Armani's outfits that are expensive. They like to wear these expensive outfits because when people see them, they look dignified and classy. Yet at the same time, their hypocrisy makes all of it a show. Some people like titles because it makes them sound important. I was once at our high school reunion a few years ago, and I heard one of my classmates introduce himself as, "Hi, my name is the physical therapist." My name is Alex. I'm just an ordinary guy. People like titles. Some titles are necessary in secular places, but we often use titles as a leverage to make ourselves seem more important in the eyes of the public. Some people have to have the best seats in the house. They sit in seats closest to the host. Some people run and make a beeline to the head of the table so that they can be the center of attention. Maybe you can relate to some of these things and how you behave and how you have behaved in the past. If you feel convicted, it's okay. It's the work of the Holy Spirit. All you have to do is repent and ask for forgiveness. 1 John 1:9 says that if we confess our sins, Jesus is faithful to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. In conclusion, church, this is why we don't follow men. We follow Jesus. This is why our mission statement is our existence as a church is to grow in Christ, to love Christ, and to share Christ. We are Christ-centered, not man-centered. I know you guys. You don't come here because of a pastor. You come here because of Jesus. You attend Crosswalk because of Jesus, and His word is preached here. You see, there is only one true teacher, and His name is Jesus. How can you tell that Jesus is the only true teacher? Here's how. As the creator of the universe, when He came down to this earth, He could have clothed Himself in majestic clothing. Instead, He put on a tunic. He could have traveled Galilee in all of Judea in first class luxury traveling. But He traveled on a donkey. He could have stayed in exotic resorts, but He had no place to lay His head on. He could have taken the best seats in the synagogues and at the temple. Instead, He ate with sinners and tax collectors. He could have demanded to be served, but He came to serve. He could have condemned sinful men and women. Instead, He died for them. Amen. He didn't just put on human flesh. But he came to put on human flesh so that he can save us. Crosswalk, behold Jesus as God and man. May he be glorified. Would you stand with me?